for the most part, you may have noticed that in our world today that people call Christian, what people call Christian worship has taken on many different forms. And some of them, I've actually had people tell me that they're downright scary. That leaves many people begging the question, are these worship forms as different and even opposed sometimes as they are to one another? Are they, are these many different worships really about God or acceptable to God or even God-oriented? Are these forms from God or are they molded maybe after the world that we live in? In my discussion of worship with the person I met, the topic came up, and it was interesting to hear what I assume many people in this world believe. As we had opposing views of what worshiping God was all about, the conversation ended with this person saying, well, you worship God how you want to, and let me worship God how I want to. That was the moment I had a disturbing yet all too familiar realization concerning what people claim to be Christian worship, the way I want to worship. For the most part, those who claim to be Christians also believe or claim that there is no given pattern of worship in the scripture. This, of course, gives license to people then to do whatever they feel like doing, whether it concerns singing, music, taking the Lord's table, or any of the other things that we do in worshiping God. In fact, it gives them license to go live their daily lives the way they want to. They believe and understand that worship is what we like and what we want to do. But we need to understand that living, that worship is more than just Sunday morning. It is a daily living. It's a daily way of living our lives for God. I want to put forth the premise this morning that God indeed has given and desires us to worship in accordance with a form from Him. He's given us that form. Now, this may fly in the face of those who bought into the concept of the false teaching of contemporary worship. But the name contemporary should give that away, as it means the conforming of worship to the circumstances around you. In other words, it is worship based on where our society is at today and what is acceptable in our society and what is pleasing to our society. Notice here that God isn't even in the picture of that worship. So my premise is backed by scripture. It's based upon God's truth. And I want to encourage you to become a true worshiper, whom Jesus said God desires. To be a true worshiper, the first thing we need to understand is, what is spiritual worship? God is looking, Jesus said, for a particular kind of worshiper. So I want to begin our lesson by going directly to the Lord and hearing what He has to say, because I believe that the Lord knows best what God wants for worship. In John chapter 4, Jesus has a conversation with a Samaritan woman at the well, at Jacob's well. The ensuing conversation ends with Jesus talk and her talking about worshiping God. And the woman was a Samaritan, and she was at odds with the Jews. They worshiped differently. Jesus shared a truth with her about worship, and it turns her world upside down, but in a good way. Jesus says in John chapter 4, verse 23, but the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For that Father is seeking such people who worship Him. God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and truth. Seeing that God is seeking these worshipers, the fact that Jesus says these worshipers must worship in this way indicates here that there is a form of worship that God desires. See, according to Jesus, this worship isn't based on a specific destination or a specific building or a specific place on earth. In fact, it's not based on any kind of physical boundaries. No physical limitations. Instead, true worship is about the spiritual nature, not the physical nature. See, God is spirit, and so the only true worship that is acceptable to him is spiritual worship. Spiritual worship is what comes from the inner man, from the soul of man, from the heart of man. It is the spirit of man bowing in reverence to God, paying homage to him. Spiritual worship is having the right attitude toward God, who is worthy of all of our praise, honor, and glory. It is holding God in high regard so as not to even try to do anything but pay homage in reverence to him. It is having a deep desire in your heart for God over everything and anything else. The spiritual worship of God is often manifested, however, in physical ways. Though it is spiritual, it sometimes comes out because we are also physical beings. The difference between spiritual worship and physical worship can sometimes be a slippery slope for us, and it can be misinterpreted by man, because man can't always read the hearts. Or doesn't read hearts. In 1 Samuel 1 and verse 13, Hannah was praying to God silently in her heart. She was at the temple. She was worshiping God, and Eli thought she was drunk. You see, he looked at her, and he thought, this woman is drunk. Look what she's doing. See, and that's how easy it is for us to misread the heart. Hannah was worshiping God. She was in spiritual worship, praying to him. Prayer is a worship of God. So the difference can be hard to distinguish for us who can't read hearts. Spiritual worship is not motivated or brought on by anything physical. It is all about the heart and the inner man. Having said that, it does manifest itself physically. That is because spiritual worship is deeply rooted in the Word of God, the Word that we are to be living in our lives every day. So true worshipers will worship God in spirit and in truth. That is the only worship, Jesus says, that is acceptable to God. And so I want us to look how Paul helps us to understand this in Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12 and verse 1. I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Bob and John were best friends. They did everything together, except for one thing. Bob didn't have any faith, and John was a churchgoer. So one day, Bob suggested they have a Super Bowl party and watch the football game. That happened to be Sunday morning. And John said, no, I have to go to church. And Bob said, oh yeah, I forgot, you're a churchgoer. Do you see a problem there? Do you know what the problem is there? See, John did everything with Bob, and I'm saying everything. And Bob didn't see him as anything different than he was, except John was a churchgoer. To many people, they believe Christianity is about attending church Sunday morning, and then the rest of the week is their life to live the way they want to live it. It's called compartmental Christianity. Christianity is, here I do this, that's, I'm a Christian. Here I do that, I'm a Christian. Over here, I'm living my life. Over these other places. And the two never dare to mix. Spiritual worship doesn't happen on Sunday mornings exclusively. It isn't about this building. It is about us coming together Sunday morning with all of our hearts desiring to worship God. But that desire should carry on through the entire week. And it shows in how we live our lives. Because Paul is saying the way we live our lives is a spiritual worship to God. So in Romans 12:1, when he says this about, he says, by the mercies of God, we first have to understand that we have the opportunity to do this because of God's great mercy and grace and his love for us. But what Paul is saying here is the dead animals of the sacrifice on the altar are swept off the altar of God. And Paul says that is to make room for you, for me, for all of us to be on that altar as living sacrifices. We don't die as a sacrifice anymore. Jesus did that for us. But we are on that altar as living sacrifices. That means we are pouring out our grateful hearts. Every act of life that we live is prompted by the love of Christ. So it is acceptable. It is an acceptable sacrifice to God, the way we live our lives. In Christ, the slain lamb of the sacrifice on the altar of God is replaced by our living actions, our adoration of him, our obedience to him, our denial of self, all for his glory and honor, because he died for us and saved us from certain death. Paul says in our spiritual worship, we are to be set apart. We're holy. It needs to be holy, set apart, without blemish, purified by the blood of Christ, which makes it acceptable to God. And the scripture is so clear on how we are to live those lives as a sacrificial worship to God. All other living, all other worship, all other ways, whether you put on a front over here in this compartment and then over here you're somebody else, that is all vain worship. That is all unacceptable to God. It is ignorant worship. It is worship that is not commanded by God or desired by God. We are not to go around and invent worship of God as if man in his sinful state could do anything pleasing in the eyes of a pure and holy and righteous God. We are to abide in his word, which reveals his requirements or his desires for our worship of him. Obedience in doing what God wants is the highest service we can be called to in this life. It matters very little what other people think of us if we are doing what God approves of, because then that is acceptable to God. And obviously, what they are doing is not acceptable to God. To please him should be our highest aim in life. And so Paul is telling us that our daily living should be a sacrificial living. It is a denying of self to do everything and anything that God desires and that glorifies him because of his great mercy that has saved us, wretched sinners. There is no doubt that God is spirit and he desires spiritual worship. But we are physical and sometimes struggle with this whole concept. But we also have a spiritual nature and the two work together. And it is part of how we worship God. King David was a physical man and he was also a spiritual man. That is the dual nature of mankind. David did some awful things in with his physical body and in his physical life. And he paid for those sins. He was tormented by those sins, even as we are sometimes tormented by our sins. Hopefully our sins torment us enough to help us to repent. And yet the Bible tells us that David was a man after God's own heart, Acts 13:22. The Bible says a few times regarding the kings that followed David that their hearts were not wholly devoted to God like their father David's was. So we get a glimpse there of what a spiritual and a physical person is. We may fail at times physically, and that is why Paul encourages us by the mercies of God to strive to be the living sacrifices that he wants us to be. We may mess up at times physically, but we want to make sure that our hearts are always in the right place. And we know that of David, because when he was confronted on his sin, he didn't make any excuses. He said, guilty as charged. Woe is me. I sinned. In the same way that David worshiped God, our worship is often manifested in our physical nature, because we have both natures, the physical and the spiritual. But it always has to be the physical. It always has to be the physical reflecting the spiritual, and not the spirit. This doesn't make sense. Okay, just a minute. It has to be the physical reflecting the spiritual, not the spiritual reflecting the physical. The sacrificial lives that we are to live in praise and honor of our Lord are laid out for us in Scripture. This is the truth part of worship in spirit and truth. Jesus has showed us and given us instruction for to be living sacrifices. In the gospel, we've discovered, or it has been revealed to us, the true nature of worship and the true nature of God. If in it we find true salvation, the true nature of the human soul, we learn about earthly and heavenly things. Jesus puts this in opposition when he's talking to the Samaritan woman at the well. He puts it in opposition because what he's dealing with there is the Samaritan defective worship, because they didn't understand all things, and the Jewish carnal worship, because they were focused on the letter of the law and not on the spiritual. And so we have two different kinds of worship going on, and neither one of those worships were what God desired. And so Jesus said the time is coming and is now, that the true worshipers will worship in spirit and truth, not having like the Jews necessarily, not like the Samaritans necessarily, but the way God desires it to be. Something we always have to keep in mind when worshiping God is the purpose of our worship. What is the basis of it? And what is our focus in our worship? Because this was kind of the hang up of the Samaritan woman and of the Jews. They struggled with this. It isn't about me and what I want. It isn't about everything that I like and that pleases me, but it is everything about what God wants and what God desires. See, our purpose of worship is not to elevate ourselves or to have people praise our spirituality or our devotion to God. The Pharisees did that. And Jesus said, woe to those Pharisees. Our whole intention has to be about God. Who he is, the almighty, eternal, loving God in heaven, who created us and sustains us by his mercies, who by his love has redeemed us from sin to be his very own, his holy priesthood. Also, we need to remember who he is in our relationship with us. He is God. He is our Lord, our King. He is our leader, our guide, our caretaker and protector. And he does everything for us. And so when we worship him, that ought to bring the worship from our heart with a desire and a devotion for praising him for all of the things that we are and have. It has to come from the heart. So the truth is that in Christendom, worship has become so contaminated by man, by his desire and influence, that most people are left either confused, misguided, or not understanding what worship is. Much of the so-called Christian worship that we see these days is more about what man thinks than is what is acceptable to God. It's more about pleasing man or what feels good or feels right to him. Man has always struggled with this because man struggles with being in submission to God. Submitting to God's will is the only thing that will clarify for us what true worship is. And Satan is all too willing to help convince man that it's okay with God if we just do what we like. It will please him. The thing is that worship is not designed to please man or to even make man feel good necessarily. Worship is about glorifying God and honoring him in humble submission and in reverence for who he is. The scripture tells us that sinful man cannot please God unless he is redeemed by the blood of Jesus. And then in Jesus, we are created to do good works. This worship has to begin in the heart of men, brought about by the great acts of God and demonstrating his love, mercy, and grace to us. He has redeemed us through his Son for the very purpose of worshiping him as he designed us to be and worship to be. Spiritual and true worship is all about God from start to finish. We are simply the vessels that are offering up this worship. This worship must be acceptable to God, and the only way it's acceptable to God is if it pleases him and it's what he desires. So if you have a need this morning, if you have a question about that, if you want to understand more, if you have a need that we can help you meet, please let us know as we sing praises to our God this morning.